The background for this conversation is the renewed financial stress in emerging market economies associated with the recent global tightening coming from the US. Mm-hmm. This is posing all kinds of challenges for some emerging market economies, and I think in particular for Indonesia. So I'd like to put my first question to you, if I may. Sure. I mean, if I may say, you are recognized as an extraordinarily energetic and purposeful finance minister. Indonesia's economic policy is shipshape. Mm. You know, the economy is doing well, you have low public debt, fiscal policy is under control, mm-hmm. inflation is low, mm-hmm. and yet this year we've seen your currency hammered in financial markets. Mm. I wondered if you could give us a sense of the problems this external financial environment creates for you as a policymaker, and how optimistic you are that you can deal with these problems.
Well, as an emerging country, you describe well what is the nature of our situation today. Indonesia is more than $1 trillion US dollar economy with 260 million population. Our economy growing at around 5.17 or 5.2% in this case, with the inflation around 3%, and it's been stable low for 4 years. This is really relatively new for Indonesia, but that's telling a lot about the credibility and ability of both central bank and government try to combine both higher growth with stability in place. We work very hard since the global financial crisis, or even before that Asian financial crisis, 97-98, when we have to build out the whole financial system in terms of the fiscal consolidation, but at the same time try to use fiscal policy as a tool to achieve development goal. Indonesia is still emerging developing country. We have less than 10% of population under poverty, but we are making a lot of progress. Gini coefficient is also declining. So we do the right thing. Using the macro policy as a prudent and sound, we focus on productivity by investing more on human capital, infrastructure, and we try to create more space, room for the private sector through many instruments, public-private partnership, and so on. So what went wrong this 2018? Not in Indonesian side, in my view, of course, as finance minister, what went wrong in the environment, and Hank Paulson mentioned quite a lot earlier in the speech. We have the current account deficit, which is around 3% of our GDP. In the past 2 years, which is less than 3% of our GDP, we're able to have the capital flow to Indonesia. So current account deficit financed comfortably with the capital flow, both in the form of FDI, as well as short-term portfolio capital inflow, which when the US normalization already taking place, because the Federal Reserve is already increasing interest rates since, 2015, but the acceleration starting as well as the communication starting in 2018, together with tightening. So in the past 2 years, when we have the same current account deficit, we can attract around 29 billion surplus on a capital. So the deficit from the current account deficit is easily can be financed. Suddenly in 2018, this increasing interest rate and the movement out of capital from emerging country make us the same current account deficit. And by the way, the current account deficit is not for consumption. This is a measure of infrastructure development. This is a measure of production taking place, investment that require capital good to be imported in Indonesia. So it has nothing wrong. Tarman has already mentioned in many during the annual meeting. It's not a sin to have a current account deficit, especially sure. for an emerging country like us, and especially a responsible current account deficit. But why we have to now have to deal with the mood of capital outflow and interest rate which is increased? Without blaming outside, but for Indonesia, meaning that we really need to be very careful now. Financing, cost of financing is becoming expensive, and liquidity is tight, meaning that we have to be even more disciplined, looking more on all the project as well as engine of growth. Are they justified? What does it mean? In general, development maybe need to be a little bit, have to be scrutinized, and that means we should be really careful in combining our ambition to reach development goal, growth high, employment, and poverty reduction, with our affordability under current circumstances. It's a very sad story in a way, because if it is only capital flow, actually we can always discriminate Indonesia comparing to the other emerging country who has this vulnerability. Indonesia, debt to GDP ratio is only 30%. Our fiscal deficit is lower than 2%. Primary balance is close to zero. So even in this case, we try to be positive. So nothing wrong on the fiscal policy. We have foreign financing on local domestic bond around 37%. In a good time, normal time, they call it a confidence from the foreign to buy our domestic bonds. In the current situation, they say that we put ourselves in a vulnerable situation. So, I mean, you cannot trust the assessment in this case. You have to trust what you're trying to do in this case. Is it really good for the economy?
This goes to the broader question, which I wanted to put to you, Ravi, next. I mean, is this just an unavoidable fact of life? You've written and spoken about the the danger of a sort of, I think you've used the term knee-jerk, risk-off mentality in the markets, that's what we saw. And that is part of what's driving some of these EME currencies down. Is this a sort of an unavoidable fact of life that EME governments just have to deal with it in the way we've just heard? Or is there something wrong with the system? I mean, is there something in the international financial architecture that we could tweak, that we could adjust, that would make this problem less serious?
Well, Clive, I think coming from a tiny country, we pretty much take the world as it is, as a given, and we learn how to ride with it, with its ups and downs. These cycles are, I think, intrinsic to global markets. Business cycles are not going to go away. Financial cycles are not going to go away. They are fundamentally determined by human sentiments, fear and greed. And people keep making mistakes, or they make new ones. So I think these are facts of life. I think the deeper question we got to ask ourselves is, how prepared is the world for such cycles and for the next crisis? Yes. There will be another financial crisis. We've not banished financial crisis. But it's going to look very different from the last one. And that's what we need to focus our minds on. Less on what's going to trigger it, less on whether we can, you know, banish them as a fact. So if you look at that, I think the fault lines that led to the last financial crisis have been mostly addressed. We've seen probably the most unprecedented set of financial regulatory reforms in scale and scope for a long time. Banks today have more capital, they have more liquidity, they have less leverage. The systemically important banks have been identified and are subject to higher loss absorbance, tighter supervision, and recovery resolution plans are in place. Many of the leading jurisdictions have resolution regimes in place now. So I think we've addressed some of the fault lines that led to the last crisis. OTC derivative markets are safer. There is central clearing, trade reporting, margining requirements in place. If you then ask, where are the risks? Well, the risks have not gone away. There's a dictum in physics. Energy is never destroyed. It just gets translated into other forms. One could almost say that about risk in financial markets. It just goes to different places. And I think it has, if you want to go understand where the risk has gone, I'd say follow the leverage. Where has debt gone? And I think there have been three shifts, one of which is the one you mentioned. There's been a shift in leverage from advanced economies to emerging market economies over the last 10 years. On balance, advanced economies have deleveraged from very high levels of leverage pre-crisis, whereas because of the very loose liquidity conditions globally, because of expansionary monetary policies in the West, leverage has built up in the emerging economies. So leverage has shifted. I would say some risk has shifted. And we're seeing some of that, the effects of some of that today. But there are two other areas where I think not enough attention has been focused, with all the focus on emerging economies. One is that the extension of credit has shifted now from banks to non-banks. because of tighter bank regulation, lending by banks has been more responsible generally, although there are still gaps in underwriting standards in some parts of the world. But by and large, a good part of lending has started to shift to non-banks, subject to various degrees of regulation. And this is something we need to watch very closely. If you take the United States, for instance, more than half the mortgage lending today is done by non-banks. Pre-crisis, it was just about 9%. So this is a huge shift, and we've got to ask ourselves, how good are these underwriting standards? Who is funding these non-banks? If these loans go bad, what are the repercussions through the financial system? Or the it could be outside the banking system, but it's still part of the financial system. So that's something to watch. Even in China, P2P lending, it's outside the banking sector. So when credit extension moves out of the regulated sector into semi-regulated sectors, that leverage needs close monitoring. The third shift that's taken place, the first is advanced emerging economies, second is lending from banks to non-banks, third is the shift of indebtedness or leverage from the financial sector to the non-financial sector. There's been a lot more corporate bond issuance since the crisis. Leverage in the financial industry has come down, but leverage in non-bank, non-financial corporate sector has gone up across advanced and emerging economies. And in the emerging economies, to add to that risk, a good part of that corporate borrowing is in dollar denomination. That adds another dimension of risk. So I think if you want to step back, rather than ask, is there something wrong with the system as a whole, is to say, well, take as a given that risk is going to keep shifting around, and our job is to be very alert and watchful to where that risk and leverage is shifting, because the two of them go together quite well.
Okay.
And ignite crisis.
I'm not quite ready to give up on the question of whether there's something wrong with the system, but I'll come back to that in a minute. First of all, Janet, I'd just like to hear your reaction to what Ravi just said. But, you know, the progress that's being made on financial regulation, you know, how would you grade that internationally? Is it enough? Are you worried about backsliding? Do we need to do more? You know, what's your overall take about where things stand on the financial regulation front?
So I agree very much with Ravi's characterization of where things stand. We had unprecedented international efforts in the aftermath of the crisis to build a more resilient financial system with special focus on banks and derivative markets. And Ravi described the improvements in capital and liquidity, safer arrangements for derivatives, resolution plans, beginning of dealing with too big to fail, and international efforts to war game how we would deal with the collapse of a global financial institution, which is a very complex matter requiring international cooperation. So all of that's good. And to my mind, I'd call that glass half full with respect to financial stability. But I worry about two things. One is the migration of risks to other areas, which Ravi described, and I think the buildup in non-financial corporate debt is a good example of a new risk that's emerging in the financial system. Now, I think prior to the crisis, at least in the United States, our monitoring efforts with respect to emerging risks in the financial system were almost non-existent. We supervised banks, but we had no comprehensive effort to monitor the entire financial system for emerging risks. That's something that has changed in the United States. The Federal Reserve's doing that. We have a new financial stability division that's focused on it. We have international efforts, both through the IMF and the Financial Stability Board. Perhaps those need to be better coordinated, but we are more attentive to the emergence of risks outside the banking sector. But it's unclear that we actually, at least in the United States, have appropriate tools to deal with these emerging risks. So You know, even when it comes to bank origination of corporate debt that's packaged into CLOs, packages of loans, I think the focus in the United States remains microprudential. So the Fed has had some authority there. We have seen growing risks in non-financial corporate lending over the last several years. We've put in place supervisory standards about that lending. But I think the authority really only pertains to what I'd call microprudential risks. Yes. You know, by and large, banks that originate this debt, and we've seen deteriorating underwriting standards on that debt as well as weakening of covenants, unless it's a threat to the bank itself, to its own safety and soundness, the authority of banking regulators in the United States to regulate this debt is very limited. And to the extent that it migrates as it is outside the banking system to non-banks that are originating this debt, it's the Financial Stability Oversight Council arguably has some authority, but really very limited authority. So I don't think we have all the tools, even in the United States, to deal with the emergence of risks. And then you mentioned rollback of financial regulations. And I wouldn't say that I see major rollbacks at this point as occurring in the United States. And I suppose having participated myself in 7 or 8 years of writing thousands of pages of regulations, I'm sympathetic to industry concerns about regulatory burden, and I do think regulators have a responsibility to try to simplify regulations and look for unintended consequences. But I do see the sentiment and the push is now going very much in the direction of deregulation, reducing buffers, reducing authorities, and I am worried about where this is going. And it's really only been a decade since the financial crisis, and it is really too soon to be moving in that direction.
Right. Well, let me have another go at the broken system point, and what I'm thinking is that there's a sort of underlying paradox in a lot of this discussion, which is that we have an increasingly globally integrated capital market. Many of the problems we're discussing, including the pressure on countries like Indonesia, which have done everything right and now having to deal with this challenge, arises from the fact that we have an integrated global capital market. But we do not have, as it were, an appropriately cooperative framework for developing monetary policy. In particular, and even more, I would say, we lack a comprehensive international framework for working together on financial regulation. I mean, in the immediate aftermath of the crash, there was an effort, and that was impressive, to address these problems collectively. But am I wrong to think that the energy behind that drive faded over time? And now financial regulation discussions tend to happen more at the domestic level than at the international level. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong. And monetary policy decisions are made exclusively at the domestic level. Now, there are good reasons for this, I don't doubt, but there does seem to be a gap here, a gap between the global capital market and lack of, as it were, infrastructure for developing policy in an appropriately cooperative way. That's what I'm trying to get at. Now, you've been a very senior official at the World Bank. You've seen this challenge of international cooperation at the policymaking level. Does what I'm saying resonate with you? Is this an issue or not an issue?
Well, first, if you look at 2008-2009, sometimes maybe we overqualified that the world at that time agreed to move together. It's because I think at that time, at that particular 2008-2009, all, especially the G20 leaders, see that they can use all the instrument and the direction of the policy is one direction.
Yes.
So whether this is counter-cyclical in the fiscal or monetary policy, so their domestic agenda with their global concern converge. This is not happened today. And like politics is always local, monetary policy is always local, fiscal policy is always local, because that is exactly how we elected, not by the IMF or World Bank, but by our own people. So, but for emerging country, when you talk about monetary policy, are they really local? It's not. Mm. I mean, the fact that now that Indonesia inflation is low, or fiscal policy deficit is low, the banking sector strong, capital adequacy ratio above 22%, lending rate is still, the growth of the credit is only 12%, it's not really excessive. But our central bank have to increase the interest rate not because of the potential capital inflation, of the inflation. Mm-hmm. It's because they want to maintain the differences with the Federal Reserve and other emerging country. So it's not purely local, because then during this kind of pressure, they look at the environment, which is becoming a bigger threat rather than domestic agenda. Just like our fiscal policy, although fiscal policy may not really change daily like monetary policy or weekly in this case, we have to do through the legislation. But the design of fiscal policy have to bear in mind what is the environment in which we are doing. My fiscal deficit for 2019 is going to be lower. We plan to have a lower foreign player in order for us to deepening our bonds market. These are all as a response of how we should reduce the vulnerability when the threat is coming from outside. When the outside is so comfortable, then we look at how we can be yes. more ambitious. So in a way, I think that is what is the discussion about globally, the cooperation, you said IMF, World Bank in this case. There is quite a lot of working and really make this convergence in terms of standard. I think the response since the financial crisis, when we talk about macroprudential monetary policy with microprudential, they are all has been adopted. Basel rule has been adopted. And we sometimes even have to worry about if this regulation driven by the need, like the advanced country like United States, is there any consequence for the country which is still like behind? There is always unintended question when you are too focused on a race in an advanced country by a certain actor or corporation, then there is an unintended consequence to the developing country and emerging country. We may have a legitimate objective, but then have to bear a lot of like anti-money laundering, financing for terrorism, and all those issues, which has become a regulatory burden. It is important, it is necessary, but still they are regulatory burden. Or trade financing, which is becoming stifled because of the issue about money laundering, about financing for terrorism. So this kind of thing that we have to accept the fact that 192 countries in the world, they are not at the same level of development. They are not at the same level of what you call sophistication. So the question when we talk about globalization as if this is one homogeneous world is wrong. What I see as a failure, you talk about systemic in this case, is that our ability to always come up, and especially during this time, which is the rhetoric is becoming more zero-sum game, then the powerful is becoming dominating and less mindful of what is weaker position. And that's worrying because just not long ago, 2015, we are all talking about MDG is already achieved, SDG is going to be achieved. We, the world, can go together, prosperity can be shared, poverty can be reduced into almost zero. That was like a global environment and global initiative in which we, although not perfect, but we work and cooperate together. This time is becoming very thorny and getting difficult, and that's worrying.
I'm just wondering if there is a sort of institutional fix, or not the whole answer, but a step in the right direction to this sort of missing layer of cooperation. I mean, you'll be aware, of course, you know, that Raghu Rajan, a former Indian Central Bank governor, has called for, you know, a more explicit, even institutionalized degree of cooperation in the making of monetary policy. And I think that strikes many central bankers, and especially in the U.S., as an impossible dream, that monetary policy has to be local. I mean, there's a political mandate on most central banks which is domestic. But what do you think, Ravi? I mean, is there scope for sort of institutional innovation? The reason I'm pressing this is it's the theme of this conference. You know, we have a global capital market, and there seems to be a lack of institutional cooperation in making this system work to our mutual advantage. So I'm asking if there are things that might be done to move the system more in that direction.
Yes, Clive, I think there are things. There are many good suggestions on the table. And let me take a crack at trying to address that. First, domestically, because I think you can't run away from the necessity, absolutely, of keeping your own house in order. Yeah. And second, internationally, as you correctly point out, because we live in an interdependent world, and risk does not respect boundaries, it crosses boundaries, and we need to take a coordinated, integrated approach. And there are a few things we can do on that front. But let me start with domestic, because we've not fixed the domestic lacuna in the system, and I think Janet pointed to that. If risk does not respect entity boundaries or sectoral boundaries and flows to where there is least resistance, like water, then I think regulation needs to be nimble and flexible to address that. And many countries are, I think, shackled by narrow mandates and legal and legislative barriers that limit their effectiveness in addressing risk when it's gone to non-banks, to non-financial sector, and so on. So I think we need a more nimble approach. And I would dare say that some of the emerging economies have been quite innovative in doing this. Especially with respect to macroprudential measures. And in many countries in Asia, for instance, we employ these tools to address risk directly in the real estate sector, which is a major source of vulnerability in many of these economies, and to curtail demand in the real estate sector through a variety of prudential and non-prudential tax measures. Many of us have done that and succeeded to varying extents. And I think that's important. I think in India and Indonesia, and Sri Mulyani may speak to it, there are even restraints on corporate lending in foreign currency. Now, that's going even further to where the risk is. If corporates are borrowing in foreign currency and pose a systemic risk, then you have to find a way in which to address that. And I think that there are some very interesting innovations in emerging economies on this front. That's worth looking at. Moving to the international front, I fully agree. Even if everything is done properly in the house, and again, Indonesia is a classic example, you run your affairs well, but you're still subject to the vagaries of international financial flows, which can sometimes be erratic and irrational. We need some mechanisms. I think there are three. One is global regulatory coordination. And I think the Financial Stability Board, which I'm a member of, and all the G20 countries are in it, there is very good conversations and actual plans put in place and implementation monitoring. There's a dashboard that looks at the implementation of these various standards and reforms country by country, sector by sector.
And this is guiding policy, you would say?
And this is guiding policy, because when the minister goes to the G20 meeting and looks at the dashboard and sees red boxes across his country,
right,
he turns around and asks, so what's happening, right? This is real, this is happening. So I think that kind of peer pressure to implement measures that we have collectively agreed is a powerful thing, and we should keep at it. I think you're quite right. The political and public enthusiasm for this has diminished somewhat, and this is to be expected as the memories of the crisis fade away. But I think regulators and central banks need to be focused, and they are. A second element which you touched on, monetary policy. I agree with Sri Mulyani. This is, and I'm sure Janet will say the same thing. It has to be guided principally by a domestic mandate, because that's what we owe to our legislatures and our own citizens and public. But we also need to recognize that the monetary policy actions of especially large economies just do have powerful implications for other countries. And I think there's been good progress in having conversations around this. Some of the best conversations, I think, occur at the BIS, which Janet and I attend, where I think there is a great deal of very candid sharing by each central bank as to what's happening, and then they get to hear from the others how it's affecting them. Now, I think this is something that's important, that while you can't explicitly build in spillover effects into your objective function, when you make those decisions, you're fully aware now how it affects others, and that has bounce back effects on you, and you're more cognizant. I think.
But this is a political reality you're describing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't want to put words into your mouth, but I mean, it seems to me the logic of that position is ideally, you know, in an ideal world, one would want these decisions to be taken in such a way that the spillovers were formally recognized, somehow weighted. But that isn't going to happen. That's a political non-starter.
Not so in a formal legal way. I think that's quite far off. But I think in an informal way, there's greater recognition. And in the IMF, for instance, the spillover reports do reflect some of these things. I think before we start formalizing these arrangements, we need to build up awareness and consciousness of spillover effects. I think that's happening.
It's happening.
But it's going to take a while. Third, and I think this is quite important, even if you did all these things, markets are still going to come back and bite you. Sure. Bad things happen to good countries. And we need ways in which they can tide over. And I think if you have global capital markets, you need some form of global financial safety net.
Yes, I was going to ask you.
That is sorely lacking today. Many of these countries are fundamentally sound, doing the right things, but they're facing short-term liquidity pressures, mostly dollar funding pressures.
Yeah.
The US dollar remains by far the most dominant currency. Even as its relative economic size diminishes, the dollar's role since the global financial crisis has risen, if anything. We're living in a more dollarized world, which is what I mentioned earlier. Foreign currency borrowings through the debt market or the banking sector by emerging economies is largely dollar denominated, which means the dollar has a much larger role in the economy, global economy, than in just the United States. Mm-hmm. We need to recognize that collectively. We need to have mechanisms to provide emergency facilities in situations like this of dollar shortage. The same way a central bank is a lender of last resort to banks within its own jurisdiction, where it's just facing a short-term liquidity shortage. And the central bank is supposed to lend unlimited amounts at a penal rate. We don't have a similar system globally. But actually, we're all in a dollar economy. And this is something that there have been discussions on. And if we can work out something along the lines of what the US Fed did, I think, brilliantly at the height of the financial crisis, which was to extend dollar swap lines to economies. They were not used, but the mere fact of their existence calmed markets. Yes. We need a similar mechanism. And I think I'll close off by saying that many of these issues are being discussed and addressed. There is a G20 eminent persons group headed by DPM Tharman, who's here. They've addressed many of these issues and put their recommendations out. And I'm quite hopeful that at least some of them will gain traction because there's greater recognition of these interconnectedness problems.
Janet, what's your take on this? I don't feel myself that the pace of innovation has been notably rapid. I mean, I agree with you, of course, that a lot of these things are being talked about, but it's hard to put one's finger on specific innovations that are actually making a big difference. One example that occurs to me is the IMF's effort to create pre-qualified credit lines, which would serve the purpose you describe. And the take-up of these facilities has been very disappointing, I suspect, because of the stigma attached to saying that you might want to make use of them. So, yes, we're talking about it, but the innovation seems a little lacking. Would you agree with that?
I do think it ought to be a priority. We've not seen anything really other than the flexible credit lines. And I agree with you, the problem is stigma. Ravi said, I totally agree that the Federal Reserve swap lines at the worst of the financial crisis were extremely important.
Yes.
My guess is that if we ever got in a similar situation of crisis where countries with very sound policies were suffering a huge shortage of dollar liquidity through no fault of their own. And in that case, the problems were stemming from the United States, that the Fed would look seriously again at extending swap lines. But coming back to what you said about monetary policy, the Federal Reserve has not been charged by Congress with the role of being a backup supplier of liquidity, dollar liquidity, on a regular basis to economies around the world.
Right.
So this needs to be available short of a crisis situation, and its mere availability in a regular basis would diminish the odds of a crisis. So I think the IMF is the logical organization to play this role. Stigma, as you said, is a tremendous problem. I know the report that Tarman chaired with the Eminent Persons Group recommends developing something along these lines, and I really think this is a hole in the way the financial system works because of the importance of dollarization and developing a facility that would be available to countries with sound macro policies on a more regular basis is very important.
And you can see this happening as a practical matter. This is something we should be shooting for, you think?
I think so.
Yeah.
The country is using more bilateral. So for Indonesia, we are doing it with Singapore, central bank and central bank, with China, with Japan, with South Korea. And of course, after the financial crisis, 97-98, we have the ASEAN Monetary Chiang Mai Initiative. So this kind of effort, which is not yet perfect, but I think since we cannot wait while the crisis is coming, then you have to do what you can. And on the Federal Reserve, it's definitely going to be very powerful. But of course, in this case, in an exceptional in 2008, that is really exceptional.
That is.
But I think then the political support for doing that is going to be much difficult, I guess, for the United States.
For the Fed, the Fed is not authorized by by Congress to play that role in a regular basis. So I think when the Federal Reserve plays that role, it really needs, in defending that role to Congress, to explain why it is in the U.S. interest. Mm-hmm. And I think that was easy to do during the financial crisis when the U.S. problems stemming from the U.S. were creating global problems that would spill back onto the United States. Mm-hmm. But on a regular basis, it's hard to justify it. So I do think the IMF is the right organization to be doing that.
In the few minutes we have left, I wonder if we could try to look even further ahead. It occurred to me when Ravi was talking about the constraints on sort of monetary cooperation that one of the sort of brute facts of the world is U.S. dollar hegemony. One of the reasons EMEs have to take U.S. monetary policy and live with it, whatever the consequences, is that the U.S. is still such a dominant, the U.S. currency is still so dominant in the global economy. Is it outlandish to suppose that that is going to change over time and that that might be a spur to innovation in the very areas we're discussing? Do you let your mind look that far ahead, Evan?
Well, I think the dollar plays an important role in the global financial system, and it's increased rather than diminished.
Yeah. I'm thinking what happened to sterling. You see, that sort of changed the rules of the game. At some point, that might lie ahead for the dollar, don't you think? To be dethroned as the world reserve currency, and a lot of things we're discussing will look very different in that world.
Although, it's not all because the dollar is used globally as a currency. In a world where there are free capital flows, Even if the dollar were not used in emerging markets, U.S. monetary policy would have spillovers. Any country's
sure.
monetary policy has spillovers.
Because of the
so
size of the U.S. economy,
you would not get rid of the spillovers that operate on exchange rates just by changing the international role of the dollar.
Right.
I think that's inherent in a system of flexible exchange rates with open capital markets. You know, for the U.S., there are costs and benefits of the role that the dollar plays. I think there have been some benefits to the global economy of having the dollar available as a currency to be used for a great deal of international trade and borrowing. It's served as a safe haven, provided a source of safe liquid assets, given that inflation has remained low and quite stable in the United States for the last 30 years or so. I think it's provided a stable sort of numeraire. So there are benefits. I think it will be a long time before another currency achieves the role the dollar has. It's certainly not impossible in the long run.
I'd love to keep going, but I'm afraid we're out of time. We have to close here. Thank you so much for your observations. I found it very, very interesting.
Thank you. Thank you.